right. Hey, guys. Thank you guys for joining me today for another brand new video. By the way, before we start, go Bills Mafia. Gotta love Buffalo, baby. Anyways, guys, I couldn't help myself. Today, we're back for another brand new video, and we're getting to explore Genesis chapter 20. So I hope everybody is ready for that. I've put a fair amount of work into this. I think I've got some pretty cool stuff to share with you guys. Let's get into some prayer. My goodness, I love y'all, and y'all look great out there today. If nobody has said it, let me be the one to say it. You look good. You look like somebody who's ready to get a little more Jesus in their life. You look like somebody who's ready to walk out the door and glorify God in thought, in deed, in action. All of it. Let's go. Heavenly Father, we want to come before you today, Lord, grateful, thankful, appreciative, driven, Lord. Help us to remain driven, Father God. Help us to continue to praise you for who you are, for this glorious creation, for the fact that you have plans for us. This is not all just up in the air. You have plans for us, God, plans that go back to the time before time. The time before we were ever in our mother's womb. And that time before time when you knew us and you purposed a life for us, Lord. Thank you for that. Thank you for being unchanging in a world that is wishy-washy and temporal. You are the same yesterday, today, and tomorrow, Father God. You are our foundation. You are our rock. You have provided a redemptive plan and a Savior, Lord, and we look forward to spending every moment that we have left on this mortal coil praising you, glorifying you, drawing closer to you, drawing closer to the character of Jesus Christ, walking as the Holy Spirit would have us to walk, walking in your illuminating wisdom, Lord. That's what we want from you, Father God. Help us today, Lord. Help this video to nourish us that we may draw ever closer to spiritual maturity. We want to ask, Father God, that this video be able to reach out and to speak to and to touch anyone out there who is on the fence, anyone out there who is still struggling with addiction and perversion and lust and promiscuity and carnality and this self-adulating, this self-love that has just been promulgated on us, Lord, by the secular and the atheist and the wicked, Lord. Help us to walk boldly as believers, to be as certain of our eternal hope in Jesus Christ as we are of the hands at the end of our arms or the table that's in front of us, as sure of it as we are of anything. I want to pray for a hedge of protection around the lives and a blood covering over the hearts and over the minds of children and the infirm and anyone unable to do so for themselves, Lord. Help us to look at the gospel message and the servanthood that Jesus Christ modeled for us and to chase after that with our all. We thank you for the indwelling of the Holy Spirit. We praise you for your glory and your might. We thank you for our place in the Great Commission to be entrusted with sharing the gospel message, shouting it, singing it, declaring it into the furthest, darkest corners of this world. We ask that you guide us, lead us, and direct us today, Lord. And we pray all of this in the lovely, powerful, righteous, and holy name of your Son and our Savior, Lord Jesus Christ. Hey, somebody else out there, hey, shout amen if you're glad you didn't wake up the way you used to be. You know, I didn't wake up today hoping to God the cops weren't at my door. I didn't wake up today wondering why whoever was laying next to me was laying next to me. I didn't wake up today to run to the bathroom and put something in a spoon and stick it in my body. I didn't wake up today having to go out and commit some kind of crime to be able to feed some awful addiction. What did you not wake up doing? Let me know in the comments. And let's get into this, guys. Genesis chapter 20, all right? Gosh, I love y'all. Abraham and Abimelech. That's the little subheading on mine. Verse 1. Let's go, guys. And Abraham journeyed from there to the south, and dwelt between Kadesh and Shur, and stayed in Gerar. Now Abraham said of Sarah his wife, "She is my sister." And Abimelech, king of Gerar, sent and took Sarah. But God came to Abimelech in a dream by night and said to him, "Indeed, you are a dead man because of the woman whom you have taken, for she is a man's wife." Verse 4, but Abimelech had not come near her, and he said, "Lord, will you slay a righteous nation also? Did he not say to me that she is my sister, and she, even she herself, said he is my brother? In the integrity of my heart and innocence of my hands, I have done this." And God said to him in a dream, "Yes, I know that you did this in the integrity of your heart, for I also withheld you from sinning against me. Therefore, I did not let you touch her." Verse 7, "Now therefore, restore the man's wife, for he is a prophet, and he will pray for you, and you shall live. But if you do not restore her, know that you shall surely die, you and all who are yours." Verse 8. So Abimelech rose early in the morning, called all his servants, and told all these things in their hearing. And the men were very much afraid. And Abimelech called Abraham and said to him, "What have you done to us? How have I offended you that you have brought on me and on my kingdom a great sin? You have done deeds to me that ought not to be done." Then Abimelech said to Abraham, "What did you have in view that you have done this thing?" And Abraham said, verse 11, guys, and Abraham said, "Because I thought surely the fear of God is not in this place, and they will kill me on account of my wife." Let's go back and read that again. I want you to keep in mind a topic we've been touching on lately, worldly wisdom, the foolishness of man, leaning on our own understanding of things. Verse 11, and Abraham said, "Because I, Abraham, thought surely the fear of God is not in this place, and they will kill me on account of my wife." Verse 12, "But indeed, she is truly my sister. She is the daughter of my father, but not the daughter of my mother, and she became my wife. And it came to pass, when God caused me to wander from my father's house, that I said to her, 'This is your kindness that you should do for me. In every place, wherever we go, say of me, he is my brother.'" Then Abimelech took sheep, oxen, and male and female servants, and gave them to Abraham, and he restored Sarah his wife to him. And Abimelech said, "See, my land is before you. Dwell where it pleases you." Then to Sarah he said, "Behold, I have given your brother 1,000 pieces of silver. Indeed, this vindicates you before all who are with you and before everybody." Thus she was rebuked. Verse 17, so Abraham prayed to God, and God healed Abimelech, his wife, and his female servants. Then they bore children. Verse 18, final verse, for the Lord had closed up all the wombs of the house of Abimelech because of Sarah, Abraham's wife. So, in this, we really get a chance to see the blessing that is the God of Abraham, the covenant God, who, when he swears covenant, he swears them by him, because what else could he swear them by? What more holy, what more upright, what more divine and perfect and flawless could he swear them by than himself? And having sworn by himself, and having he himself sworn, God upholds these covenants. Even where man continues to drop the ball, woman continues to drop the ball, God is there. God is there. Let's jump back to the beginning, see what I have to share with you guys. My goodness, I love y'all so much. All right, so first off, welcome you lovely souls, you fellow faithful, any spiritual searchers, and all in need and want of a closer and more active walk with God Almighty. I know I'm looking for it. I'm looking to understand His Word more truly every day, to walk in His Word actively more truly every day. I have a feeling you're a lot like me on that. Let me know in the comments. So if you're new, thank you so much for joining me. I'm Rex, and for a long time, I was a decades-long junkie, heroin addict, methamphetamine addict, prescription pill addict, a criminal, deeply promiscuous, all of these things. But you know what I am now? I'll tell you this, I'm not a good actor, so what I am is what I am. And what I am now is a grateful new creation in Christ Jesus. 4 years plus into this, and I am continuing to be amazed by how complete the transformation is when God raises us to new life in Christ Jesus. And that's the spark, and that's the fuel for this channel. So check it out. You just heard Genesis 20. You were nice enough to let me share that with you. Stick with me. Stay with me. Get those shoes laced up and join, because now it's time for us to go walking in the Word. Now, before we jump into today's verses, let's look at a little bit of an overview, all right? Here in chapter 20, we have what are direct echoes of chapter 12. If you don't remember that one, please go back, check it out. I have a video on Genesis chapter 12. And in fact, they are so similar, chapter 12 and 20, as they both feature fumbles on Abraham's behalf, such as our humanity at times, that many have posited that chapter 12 and 20 are in fact flips of the same scenario. Or in other words, they're what are commonly referred to as doublets. Or in other words, two accounts of the same event. Same event, two sort of different points of view, just slightly. All right? So that's what many have posited. This falls apart upon inspection, really. But while the events aren't the same event, the iniquity being detailed is the catalyzing sin is the same. Now, thankfully, as a child of God, like me or you, Abraham was saved by the helping hand of God, and his wife was protected, and the covenant was upheld. Just as in Egypt, a faithful and trusting God upholds and preserves the line or the lineage of promise that is going to flow through Abraham onto David, onto Jesus Christ. That same line is being upheld. God upholds it because he has already established it. And what God establishes, it's not going to get undone, brothers and sisters. I have to be honest with you guys, I kind of hate my new glasses. They slide down my nose a lot, which, you know, that's a long slide in case you haven't seen it. So, all right, guys, let's look at verse 1, all right? And Abraham journeyed from there to the south and dwelt between Kadesh and Shur and stayed in Gerar. All right, so, looking at our opening verse, let's get some geographical context with chronology in mind. Gerar is a place with, I've spent quite a bit of time looking into this, it is a place with many posited locations, and I'm going to share with you the ones that stick out as having the most evidence behind them. Let's start with the most likely. Some say that Gerar would be found at modern-day Tel Serah. This is around 45 miles northwest of Beersheba. Others point at an area called Tel Harar. And Tel Harar is around 12 miles west of Beersheba. But still others, and check this out, I looked and I couldn't find a lot of great information really at all, but others point to a place called Tel Jemma, I think. It's J-E-M-M-E-H. Tel J-E-M-M-E-H. Tell Jemma. All right, so that's what we have there. Let's look at verse 2. Now Abraham said of Sarah his wife, "She is my sister." And Abimelech, king of Gerar, sent and took Sarah. He's basically said, you know, she's not my wife. From all that we can gather, she was very fair, very beautiful to look upon. And so the king came and took her. Now, Abimelech, the name, either means one of two things. It's either my father is king, or it means father of a king. Now, elsewhere, such as in Tyre, we have a ruler who used this name. And so it could be that the name Abimelech is a specific proper name for this individual in this narrative. Or it could be also that the name Abimelech is more of a moniker, more of a royal title, right? Also notice verse 2's closing language. Let's look at verse 2 one more time. Now Abraham said of Sarah his wife, "She is my sister," and here's what I want to talk about. And Abimelech, king of Gerar, sent and took Sarah. Sent and took Sarah. So this closing language of sent and took, it illustrates how nearing Isaac's conception and the fruiting of God's redemptive plan, all of this is put in peril by this "she's my sister, he's my brother" plan that they have. Saving efforts then fall onto and depend not on flawed humans, but on a faithful God, an upright God of the covenant, who is set to guard Sarah's purity and uphold what he has established. Let's look at verse 3. But God came to Abimelech in a dream by night and said to him, "Indeed, you are a dead man, because of the woman whom you have taken, for she is a man's wife." So not the kind of dream you necessarily want. Now what we need to understand about this dream is that this would not have been seen as odd. This would not have been seen as out of the ordinary necessarily. In the Near East of antiquity, dreams were understood as a common means of receiving divine communication. And so it's worth noting that such messaging was at times provided even to those outside the chosen people group, even to those outside the covenant community. So your adherence or your membership or your uprightness were not necessarily requisite in receiving such a dream. You know, God makes use of many people. You know, think of Saul and all that Saul had going on and how he was so totally transformed by everything that went on the road to Damascus and the events that followed. Look at, I don't know, but me, you know, I was so off track, so broken, so sinful, and yet God has a use for me. God has a use for you. It doesn't matter how far we've fallen. You know, God will use dark horses. He will use the foolish things of this world to shame the wise. And check it out, I was a foolish thing. All right, guys, let's look now at verse 5. "Did he not say to me, 'She is my sister'? And she, even she herself said, 'He is my brother.' In the integrity of my heart and innocence of my hands, I have done this." So outside the Holy Scriptures, creation itself declares the hand of God. Now, for those who have never been blessed with God's law, such as Abimelech here, never coming to know it, and they come face to face with God, well, they won't be judged upon their adherence to a law they've never heard. No, they will be judged, but they will be judged upon their conscience, right? See, because in effect, sin is to know what is wrong and to still do it, right? And so we know that quite often within ourselves. You know, even I see this in my granddaughters. You know, one's getting ready to be 3 and one is about a month old. And, you know, not the one that's a month old, but very soon here it will start, where you will see kids who, you know, they inherently know to hide certain things. There is something within us, a voice that is within us that will enlighten us to these things. And basically what's going on here is that is how someone like Abimelech would be judged. Let's look at verse 7, guys. By the way, if you have any questions, any comments, I want to hear them down below. Also, disclaimer, everyone should also know, you know, I'm just an ex-junkie. I'm a born-again believer in Jesus Christ. I'm not a theologian. I didn't go to college for any of this. I am profoundly interested, and I love to spend my time digging into the Bible and researching points about it, but I am not a theologian. All right. I would go into that more, but anyways, I had a comment enlightening me to that one day. Let's look at verse 7, guys. Never be scared to share the word of God, all right? Verse 7, now therefore restore the man's wife, for he is a prophet, and he will pray for you, and you shall live. But if you do not restore her, know that you shall surely die, you and all who are yours. All right, guys, so very, very, as far as clear-cut messaging go, pretty clear. Here we have what is, in fact, the very first biblical use of the title prophet. This is the very first time in Scripture that that word is appearing. Now, that said, we have, when we hear the word prophet, we have a very certain, usually a very certain connotation or outline of that in our mind. This is someone who would come out and say, look, if you don't change now, this is what God is going to do in the future. He has told me and I am delivering that message, right? That is a prophet. But that's not all that a prophet is. So that said, this does not reference so much one speaking for God, but more so one who has a profound relationship with God, one who is privy to revelation, and one who is ready and willing to be an intercessionary force on the behalf of others. And we see in that context, Abraham absolutely fits that perfectly. Right? All right, guys. Let's look now at verse 9 and talk about this great sin, right? Verse 9. And Abimelech called Abraham and said to him, what have you done to us? How have I offended you that you have brought on me and on my kingdom a great sin? You have done deeds to me that ought not to be done. So he says, why have you done this? You know, what have I done to warrant this sort of behavior? You know, you have brought upon us this great sin. Now, great sin, if we go to the translation, is from a phrase that is hyper common to the time and place. And as such, it would have been understood very clearly as legal terminology for adultery specifically, right? In fact, we know how frowned upon this action was for both the men and women involved. And this was not only frowned upon in biblical circles, but we know for a fact that this was frowned upon culturally from extra-biblical sources as well. For instance, the most notable that comes to mind would be the law of or the code of Hammurabi, which we have talked about frequently on here. Let's look at verse 11. And Abraham said, because I thought surely the fear of God is not in this place, and they will kill me on account of my wife. Man, I have read over this verse probably 50 times in the last 5 days, and it just says so much, and it breaks it down so perfectly, and it's very concise wording. We see Abraham talking to himself, basically, you know, because I thought surely, you know, we could stop right there. Because I thought, you know, there's a saying, if you want to hear God laugh, tell him your plans. You know, if you want to hear God chuckle, tell him what you think, you know, about a situation, as if you're speaking on it with authority. All right, guys. So, what we see here, and what is sadly for sure, is that Abraham was more worried about people than God. We know that Abraham, in his fear, was ready to lean more on his own understanding than what God had declared. We know, in looking at this, how profoundly broken and human Abraham was showing himself to be at this moment. Now, the term fear of God, he says, I don't find that here. Well, for us, typically, as believers, we'll say the fear of God is the beginning of all wisdom, things like this, right? And when we say that, fear of God typically is denoting one who has the fear of God is one who is a informed practitioner, one who rightly reveres God, one who rightly worships, one who rightly obeys. However, what we have to remember is that here he is walking into what is a utterly alien setting in essence, and in that framework, fear of God looks more to those who follow the framework of conscience that exists within us all, elect or not, as creations of one true creator God, right? It's not looking so much to one who knows exactly how to pray, one who, you know, remembers you do this and then this, that you worship like this, that when God says this, you do this. It's not all of that. The fear of the God that is found in places like where he was walking, where one should be looking for, is a fear of stepping outside of what is acceptable within ourselves. All right. Let's look now at verses 14 through 18, that last little section. And then we'll close up for the day. I've really enjoyed being back with a new video with you guys. I love y'all just so much. Then Abimelech took sheep, oxen, and male and female servants and gave them to Abraham, and he restored Sarah, his wife, to him. And Abimelech said, "See, my land is before you. Dwell where it pleases you." Then to Sarah he said, "Behold, I have given your brother 1,000 pieces of silver. Indeed, this vindicates you before all who are with you and before everybody." Thus, she was rebuked. So Abraham prayed to God, and God healed Abimelech, his wife, and his female servants. Then they bore children, for the Lord had closed up all the wombs of the house of Abimelech because of Sarah, Abraham's wife. All right. So I got a fair amount to share in this closing section, so let's go. Notice in verses 14 through 16, as Abimelech gives gifts to Abraham, gives gifts to Sarah, this is done to honor God and their unique relationship with God. These are not guilt gifts. These are not, geez, I can't believe I did that, buy-off gifts. We see God not only deliver, but enrich as well. He goes where he has to go, and he goes a step further. He delivers, but he enriches. Such a public vindication helps to clear the air with regards to Isaac's parentage, to put it on the absolute up and up. Moving on, it's out of this deep regard for the God of Abraham that Abimelech seeks to restore all honor to Sarah. Furthermore, as we see in verse 18, let's read that one last time here. For the Lord had closed up all the wombs of the house of Abimelech because of Sarah, Abraham's wife. So as we see in verse 18, all of this is catalyst for the reopening of these wombs of the members of this household and its females. In closing, we see the sovereign, providential hand of God at work in preventing any and all discrediting of or diminishing of or speaking down upon the birth of Isaac, the parentage of Isaac, because we know how crucial this lineage is in God's redemptive arc, right? We know how crucial it is. And again, what God establishes, man won't undo. Not fearful man, not lustful man, not angry man, not powerful man. None of that is going to overdo God. What God establishes is established. God is not persuaded by the arrogance of man. All right, guys, hey, if you're not already subscribed to my channel and you've put up with me for this long, what are we doing? Hit the subscribe button, give that little bell a little tap, and you'll get notified every time I drop a new video, which is multiple times a week. I love you guys, and if you have any comments, questions, suggestions, video ideas, put them down here in the comment section. If you have a prayer request, oh, I really want to hear that from you. Send as many as you want. And also, be as vague or as specific as you want. You know, Lord already knows the rhyme. Lord knows the reason. Lord knows who's in need. But what he likes to see is he likes us to verbalize it. He likes us to take that step towards him and declare it, right? And not only that, but when we take that step towards him and what we declare are the worries for others or thoughts for others or prayers and cares for others, oh, he loves to hear that. He loves to hear that, I promise you. If you have a witness or a testimony, and brother or sister, let me tell you this, if you're saved, you do. The story of you becoming a saved, born-again believer in Jesus Christ, that's a testimony. Talk about what you were doing before, what your life was like, what you were like, what the fruit of your life was like. And talk about what God has done and the transformation of you, what's going on this side of it. And hey, you don't have to tell it right here necessarily, but I'm telling you this. You got to tell it somewhere. You can't receive all of these blessings, all of these gifts, the indwelling of the Holy Spirit, the covering of blood by Jesus Christ, all of this, and then stay quiet about it. Man, that ain't right. That's it, guys. I love y'all. Father God loves you even more. Do me a favor. Go out there. Have a blessed day. And lift up the name of Jesus Christ wherever you go and whatever you do. And I will see you beautiful souls in the next video. Until then, G-O-E. God over everything.